In this episode, John M. Viola, president of the National Italian American Foundation, visits our office, which we call La Casa di iItaly, for a chat with our interns, four young Italian Americans who are with us thanks to a NIAF fellowship. Stay with us as John Viola shares his family history, his experience as the foundation's president, and his views about where the Italian American community is heading.
My family comes from all over Italy. My dad's family, my grandparents, both came from the southern part of Campania in the Val di Diano. But my dad's the name Viola comes from Basilicata. My great-grandfather moved to Campania, met my great-grandmother, who was from Caserta. My mom's father's from Palermo, my mom's mother's from Bari. And basically everybody came for the exact same pursuit of the American dream, mm-hmm. the difficulty. Finding work in the South, finding opportunity. And in different periods between 1890 and 1923, they all ended up over here.
So growing up, would you say was your Italian heritage a big part of your identity, or did you embrace that later on in life?
I think my Italian heritage was fundamental to my identity growing up. I think I'm probably a little bit even extreme in that assessment. I mean, I grew up in a family that was really close. Everybody lived in one building, in the same building my grandmother was born in when they got here from Italy. My dad was born in, I was born in. So it was me, my parents, my grandparents, my aunts and uncles, my great aunts and uncles. And then we moved to a suburb in New Jersey that was really not Italian. And so I think we kind of ossified in our Italianness, and it became more than definitional to who we were. So that led me to be active where I could on a national level, which led me to NIAF.
Mm-hmm. Would you say that traditions are important to you?
I am one of the most old-fashioned and traditional young people I know, so I think traditions are super important. I think they're important because they add flavor to life, first and foremost. But I think they're important because I think as much as the idea of security in family and culture is knowing that there's other people around you that you can rely on, is also a second kind of security, which is the security of knowing that somebody before you went through a similar life experience. So like, you know, raising kids, if you have traditions and family values that are passed on, you have something like a blueprint. It's not, you know, a random sort of decide as you go. I think that's really important to have.
So speaking of family and children, are there any in particular traditions that you would pass on?
Yeah, my family is, it goes from the big to the small. I mean, you know, we're very, very traditional around our holidays. When my grandfather died when I was 16, I decided that my brothers and I were gonna relieve my grandmother of having to do all the work for holidays. So we asked her to teach us everything. And she did. So, and she's since passed. And so now my brothers and my cousins and I cook everything and sort of let the adults, have the night off. You know, our holidays are filled with traditional songs, traditional foods, family traditions that are unique to us. We keep St. Joseph's Day. We try to get together every Sunday. I mean, it's very difficult. All my brothers and I live in different places now. But we try very hard when we can to all come home to my parents. We're very, very traditional. I can't see raising my kids anything but Italian when God blesses me with them.
Okay, so going back to your father, he's obviously a very successful businessman. Does he credit his Italian ancestry to his success, and has he passed on any valuable lessons to you that you use in both your professional and private life?
Yeah, I think if you ask my dad, he would credit a lot of who he is to his Italian heritage, to family values, he came from a family that definitely experienced real poverty, but stood together through it, stood strong through it, relied on one another through it. The pursuit of education was incredibly important to my family, and I think that comes from the Italian experience of, you know, trying to give a better life to the next generation. So I think he would definitely credit a good part of his success to his heritage and our culture and the natural intelligence of the Italian people.
In 2012, you were appointed the Chief Operating Officer of the National Italian American Foundation. And today, in 2017, you're actually the President of the National Italian American Foundation. So I was just wondering, during that time period, what do you think some of the changes that you've been able to make are?
We changed a lot of the foundation. We've worked really hard. We've worked to make our place, you know, over 40 years, a foundation that was created to advocate for and fight for a community that was in need, has evolved into a place that's now able to celebrate and expose and share the best of a community that's no longer in need, a community that essentially has integrated and has a lot to celebrate and share. So it's sometimes hard for an organization to do that naturally, to see that its role has evolved. And I think one of the things we've worked really hard to do is create a consciousness around the foundation that we are a different being than we were 40 years ago. And sometimes it's not as important to go out and, you know, champion when we feel like we're downtrodden or scream and yell about what's upsetting us. We tried to make our events and the opportunities to be around the foundation more accessible to people. We tried to make them more affordable, more welcoming, more family-driven. We've obviously tried very hard to reach out to young people in different ways, and you guys are a testament to that kind of programming, where it's not just about, here's your scholarship check, good luck, you know, glad you have a vowel on the end of your name. It's about integrating you into the family of what we are and building good and conscious Italian Americans. And we've done a lot of institutional stuff. We've been able to do the first annual reports in the history of the foundation. We've been able to update the website and change the membership. But I think what I'm most proud of as I look back at 5 years is that we've been able to make it feel more like home when you come.
Yeah, it's certainly important to change with the times, absolutely. Kind of piggybacking off of that first question, when you first became the president of NIAF, you had three goals that you wanted to accomplish. You wanted the Italian. So I've heard.
Must be on the record somewhere.
So you had wanted the institutions in the Italian American community to grow stronger. You wanted both Italians and Americans to learn more about each other's cultures, and you had wanted to reclaim the Italian language. What kind of progress do you feel like you've been able to make on those, you know, either in a professional level or at the foundational level?
That's a good question. Let's go backwards, because I think you guys are, again, a good testament to some of the stuff we've been trying to do. I mean, having a bilingual experience like this in journalism, in storytelling, essentially, speaks to two of those points, making sure that young Italian Americans have the opportunity to find not just the language study, but the utility in that language afterwards, you know, career-driven options. And particularly in a field like this, where you are storytellers and you are sharing the cultures between, and you are a functional bridge. And we've tried to do that with a lot of what we've created, a lot of our fellowships and a lot of our programs. I think we've been able to support financially good programs in language. I don't think we've found the perfect way to make people understand that they can reclaim their language. I think that that's something we have to improve. And I think it's a bigger task than one foundation in a few years to get the Italians and the Italian Americans to understand each other. But supporting initiatives like iItaly, which finally speaks in English on the Italian story, and supporting initiatives in Italy like we do, to reintroduce our community that I think is often misunderstood, and vice versa, to reintroduce a modern Italy that's not the Italy of your grandparents. We're proud of the work we do there. On the Italian community and the institutions, I've worked really, really hard to try to lead our foundation without ego. And you know, to be honest with you, sometimes you can't dance without a partner. You know, there's a lot of other groups out there, and many of them have done a great job of being open and able to work with us. And there's always resistance from certain quarters of leadership, but we've been able to create partnerships with the Italian American sons and daughters, Italian Sons and Daughters of America in the Midwest, 40,000 person group. I've had lunch with their president, Basil Russo, and the president of the Sons of Italy, Dan Longo, at the same table and talked about what are we going to do together. We created the Italian American Relief website for the earthquake, years ago for the earthquake in 2012. And we said, it's not going to have our logo on it, it's going to have everybody's. Everybody that sends it out, donates, will equally be branded. And this year, in the terrible earthquake in central Italy, we were able to activate that coalition without ego, in partnership, most groups on the same page, and raise $8 million. And we're really proud of that, because someone's got to sort of stand out front and say, it's not really about our brand, it's about our blood. And that's what we're trying to do.
Yeah, that's definitely impressive, and that collaboration is key.
So we have obviously been enjoying the iItaly internship, and we thank you for your support and for allowing us to grow and learn so much. Do you see yourself or NIAF continuing the iItaly internship in the future?
Yeah, I think this is great. I mean, I not because we're here, but I've always been a big believer in iItaly and what you guys are doing here. I think the idea that we can build young people who are not just fluent in both languages or, you know, fluent in the news of the day in both places, but who have a transmittable culture, a cultural sort of liquidity between the two places. That's super important, because you are unique as an Italian American. You are an American, but a distinct kind. And you are an Italian, but a distinct kind. And I think that the more you surround yourself by both cultures, the more self-aware you become, and the more you can function as a real participant in both places.
And do you feel it's important for Italian Americans and Americans to understand and know Italy as a country beyond the scope of travel?
Yeah, I mean, that's the crux of it all, is understanding Italy as a living, breathing place. So Italy, beyond even just Italian Americans, I think, to the whole world, its wealth of cultural heritage, patrimony, whatever you want to call it, sometimes makes it appear ossified. You know, if you build a modern piece of architecture, everybody else in the world goes up in arms and says, well, what about our views of Italy? And, well, you know, it's not really about your views of Italy, it's about function, it's about a country that's alive. So I think introducing a modern global Italy to the Italian American community is incredibly important, and you touch it when you travel if you have an awareness, but you have to dig a little further, I think.
And iItaly seeks to fill a void. The Italian American community, though it's 20 million strong, we don't really have a strong media platform. Why do you think this is true?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think we lack a strong media platform because we lack a language to tie us together and make us distinct. So and people will debate with me all the time about whether or not we gave up the language willingly or under duress during the Second World War. In my mind, I like to think it's duress, because I can't imagine ever giving up your mother tongue, but people had to, whether it was by choice or not. And I think that has weakened the idea of speaking to us as a group. So it's hard to have Italian language media, because there's not people who are, you know, bilingual in those numbers. It's hard to have a TV station when the majority of Italian Americans couldn't understand what was on it. But being able to speak about Italy in English, I think it proves out its success. I mean, the media entities that have survived and thrived are the ones that are in English, because people desperately want to know. They just need it in the language that they speak.
So certainly everybody at this table is here because our families had come here trying to look for a better life, look for work, whatever the case may be. My grandparents and great-grandparents came here, and they had spoken both dialect, Italian, and obviously it got lost over the years due to the standard causes of language loss that the community has experienced. But I felt that I grew up in a very in a community where I didn't fit in culturally necessarily, and I made friends with other Italian Americans, the few that there were, and I found that it was kind of like that stronghold where you felt welcome. And then when I was in middle school, they had added the Italian language to our school district's curriculum because they didn't have it before. So immediately I said, I have to sign up for this when I was in seventh grade. And I did, and of course I fell in love with the language. Then I got to the university and I decided that this is really what I wanted to study, to really just understand my culture and my roots. My parents had never been to Italy, my parents don't speak Italian, but now that I've studied it so much, I'm taking them there for the first time this summer, and I'm so excited about it, and I think they are too. My dad's a little bit, he doesn't know what to expect, but my mom, I'm always talking to her about it, so she's a lot more aware of what was coming. But I'm actually starting to teach her Italian too, and she's taking an Italian class, so I'm really trying to bring it back to, you know, the family.
That's what it's about. It's about evangelism. That's really what this whole, all culture, you know? I see it time and time again, people in our generation, your generation, who take it back.
So what do you think the future holds for the next generation of Italian Americans?
Oh boy, that's a tall order. What does the future hold? Well, I feel good about your generation. You guys are, at this point, considerably younger than me, unfortunately. But I feel good. I think the future is very bright. I look at the faces of the people that I meet, the young people that I meet, when I travel around the country, when I go to the college campuses, when we have events and they come in, and, you know, they are far more American than their parents and grandparents and whatnot, but they're also far more global. So it's much easier to wear multiple hats nowadays and feel many, many things. And you can feel things thousands and millions of miles away from them. It's so easy to access. So I think the idea of having a unique and shared identity becomes actually easier, and in many ways more beneficial. So I think the future bodes well for someone who can be multiple things. And I look at the numbers of the census and self-identification in our community, and I see how important it is for our honorees. You know, we write these videos about our honorees, and they all come back and want to talk about their kids, and we have to say, sorry, but we've only got 2 minutes to tell your life story. And so, you know, but the family is still so central, and that pride is still so real. So I think with a little bit of institutional change, there's a bright future for our community.
So, tell us about your fiancé. Is she from Italy?
That's the first question I've never heard. Somebody wins. She's not from Italy. She's Italian-American, but she's an Italian citizen. She's born here in the Bronx. Her name is Nicole Di Bona. We all pronounce it Nicole, which is totally inaccurate, but that's how her whole family pronounces it. She was an auditor at Ernst & Young until she decided a few years ago that she'd had just absolutely enough of that and decided to start a clothing line, a bathing suit line. And she's very proud of her Italian heritage. Her father came over from the Abruzzo, and her mother is from a family that her grandparents came from Tuscany. I think she's probably sick and tired of Italian events, but she comes to support me.
Wow, great. So what's the secret? What makes Italian women so desirable, so to say?
I just had this conversation with my mother today, actually. I think that, well, obviously Italian women are beautiful and intelligent and capable and stronger than Italian men by a million miles. I know that. But I think beyond all of the actual qualities of a person, there is something about being in a relationship with the person who shares your culture and your background that I think it's easy to say, you know, the normal sort of mainstream acceptable thing would be you fall in love with who you fall in love with. And that's true. And you can make any relationship work. But I do think when you've got somebody of your own culture, you've got a little bit of a leg up because you don't have to explain the things that you do and why you do them. And you don't have to negotiate the things that are of preeminent value to you. You don't have to worry about those kind of things. They're just there. You do them the same. And they're a very important foundation. So as much as passing along culture is important, is as much as it's made much easier when you have certain unwritten standards and values and rules that both of you come in with. I do find that. I mean, I'm sure Nicole will see this at some point. Obviously, I've dated a lot, and I think there's a different level of ease when the person shares your culture, at least from me.
Yeah, well, we wish you and Nicole years of happiness.
Thank you very much. If she doesn't kill me first, we'll do fine.
What's your favorite Italian song?
I love Italian music, and I love Italian folk music. I love Italian modern music, folk music, and they all have different meanings to me. I think, I don't know, there's two answers to this. For emotional sake, my grandfather was a great singer, and he loved to sing Torna Sorrento. That was his favorite song to sing. And so I heard him sing it a lot, and he was a sick man, and it, at the end it used to take a lot out of him to sing it. And I will never forget that when I hear it. So for me, that's probably the most important song in my life. And I think, well, beyond that, there's just so much good stuff. I just love Neapolitan music and Sicilian music and modern Italian music. I couldn't pick one after that, I don't think.
It is a really good way to pick the language up. It's like a natural way to learn a language, to listen to music or even watch shows in it.
You're absolutely right.
But
it's
there is
a great
good
way.
Italian music.
We tried to do a thing online, and I think I probably made it a little too boring for people, but I do love to sing, as Letizia knows. Mm-hmm. It takes a lot more than a half a glass of wine, but I do love to do it. We tried to do a Musica Monday, I think we called it, where we translated songs, because so many people sing these songs by memory and they botch the words, but that's okay because at least they're, you know, in the process. So we said, well, if we can translate them, it's an Italian lesson right there that they've already got in their head. But it didn't take off like I thought it would. Maybe I picked far too weird of song, but I think it's a great way to learn. And it's a great way to learn the regional languages too.
That's true.